Now, you may or may not realise we've got something pretty special happening tonight, right?
Yeah.
In fact, look, no matter what your friends are doing tonight, you've got those guys beat because, seriously, this is pretty bloody surreal. In fact, I still don't actually know it's kind of real. I mean, luckily I just met Yahoo Serious, so I know he's definitely here. But while I was waiting for him to turn up, it dawned on me that I've talked to this guy on the phone a few times, but I had no actual proof that it was actually Yahoo Serious and that he was actually coming. So it got a little bit scary there. I was like, okay, you may have just made the biggest mistake of your life. Now, guys, before we get this incredibly talented and enigmatic legend, Aussie legend on stage, I'll just tell you guys a little brief history of how this event happened. So, the Young Einstein anniversary was coming up. It was actually, you know, slightly just before Christmas, but don't hold it against us. You know, saw the 30th anniversary thing. We thought, look, let's play the movie again. We love this movie, one of our favorites from our childhood. I'm sure a lot of you guys grew up with the movie as well, right?
Yeah.
I'm sure you probably wore out that VHS tape. Your parents probably loved you for it. In fact, Yahoo was just saying that he's had a few parents want to murder him for that very reason. As we do, as the Orpheum does, we thought, let's book a screening of Young Einstein to celebrate the 30th anniversary. And it popped into my head that, look, I know Yahoo lives locally. I know he doesn't really do this stuff anymore. You know, he's a very private guy. The chances of him wanting to come to the Orpheum, as great as we are, to do a Q&A is pretty damn slim. So I reached out to the distributor of the film anyway. I said, look, guys, what are the chances you've got some contact details for Yahoo Serious? They said, nah, don't get your hopes up. Highly unlikely. They ended up, you know, maybe a week later, sending through an email address and a phone number, and there I was, you know, typing away, very nice little email, you know, dear Mr. Yahoo, big fans, love you, no, not interested in this at all, but would you, you know, would it enter your mind to possibly come and do a little intro or a Q&A for us in front of some fans? And about 2 days later, the box office calls me, and they say, there's a Yahoo Serious on the phone for you. Now, you know, I collect myself up off the floor because I'm obviously not expecting that. And I'm thinking, man, I'm really glad the person in the box office did not think that was a prank call. Because that sounds like a prank call. And then we proceed to have this really lovely chat with, really warm, lovely guy. You know, got really excited about the possibility of, you know, coming out and seeing some fans and telling some stories and doing all that kind of thing. Was like, absolutely, I'll be there. Let's work out a date. So we're very lucky that he's here tonight, and it's my great pleasure to welcome onto the stage one of Australia's great comedy legends, Mr. Yahoo Serious. This is not lost on us how rare an opportunity this is, so thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Woo! 30 years. 30 years for Young Einstein.
Yeah, I don't know what happened there. Well, all of you probably going anywhere did that 30 years ago. It's strange to look back And I haven't seen the film in quite some time now. And I haven't seen it on the big screen for probably 30 years or something. So I'm very excited to see it tonight. I was a bit worried because Alex, I said, where'd you get the print, Alex? And he said, oh, it was the original print. It's probably, you know. And I went, oh, well, gee, it's probably dark and it's probably got scratches. He says, no, the people that come along, they want the scratches or they don't think it's genuine.
so glad that he's talking about the quality of the print now, which now I'm going to be scrutinising more than we're going to. The fact that there's 500 people here tonight to see this movie. When you were making the movie, you had a feeling that you guys were doing something special. It was obviously something that seemed like it was working. Did you have any idea that 30 years later there'd be people still so eager to see the film on the big screen or to see yourself?
Well, I don't know if everyone knows the story of it, but it is one of those stories where nobody wanted to know about it. It's different now because I guess the name's accepted, but back then it was pretty hard to raise a dollar with a name like Yahoo Sirius. So I really just had to go out and start filming some stuff, and I didn't really know anyone that could do the stuff that I'd written, so I just went in it. I wanted to be a film director, but I didn't know. I was interested in doing something original because I used to be a painter, and you just do the one square and you do all the characters and the art direction and the whole thing. And so I had to learn to write a bit to be able to express things, so you become a script writer, and so that you really have something that you want to direct. Because if you are a painter, you're an original artist. I wasn't really interested in interpreting, being an interpretive artist, to really do something else once you've had the opportunity to do your own stuff. So I made some documentaries, and that was my own stuff, and I thought, oh, well, let's just get going with this and find some actor that can do it later. But, there wasn't anyone that served and threw themselves down 50 flights of stairs ride a horse and do all that. And so you find that when you are a writer, you reach inside to express yourself. And when you're expressing yourself, you're expressing your culture that you grow up in. And so I guess that's what I was doing. So the popularity of it in the end really was about us. And I grew up around Newcastle, and in fact, most of Tasmania, we couldn't afford to go to Tasmania. So there's a lot up around there. If ever you're taking a drive from Wallumbye, along the Wallumbye Road to Cessnock, you can still see the Einstein House you can see tonight. And the only difference is that we threw some bark on the roof. Other than that, it's right there, just before a little place called Millfield. But it's worth a look. Anyway, it was very difficult to make, and in fact I couldn't get any money to make it. It was only that I directed another thing and went to the world's first video festival in Saint-Tropez, and I was starting up MTV then, and there was a whole lot of people that was very interested in it because it was about music and stuff, but I'd only filmed a few scenes, and that started a bit of a roller coaster where I could raise little bits of money along the way and film more and more to fill it in. I think it was about 3 or 4 years before we eventually finished it. And I didn't know really what we had. I knew it was very different. But I knew it was about us. But what I found out was it was really about everybody. There was something about when you tap into your own story and you do it genuinely within your culture, it's a bit universal and quite strange that it was a bit of a hit around the world. And that very much surprised me. I wasn't ready for what happened, and I was just telling Alex I made Reckless Kelly, a modern day Ned Kelly film, to really get over what had happened in young Einstein, and then with that film it looked again at the culture. I think that was about Mabo at that time, and I saw the Banks as not as particularly good guys then, so. And rob ATMs, which had just come out then, and we deposit the money in the bank accounts of people that can't pay off their housing loans. So the same stuff is relevant. But I guess getting back to Einstein, there was some upstairs. There was the genesis of it was a mate and I were travelling down the Amazon River, and there's not much to do on the Amazon River. We got on up we went down, there wasn't a lot to do, and so we put in and we'd buy some beer at each of the little mission stations and stuff. And one of them, after about 2 weeks, a guy came on board and he went with our boat for a while, and he was a guy that would sell a beer. And I've got a picture of him on my wall at home, and it's a picture you might have seen of Einstein poking his tongue out in about the age of 72 or something. And then I knew a bit about him. I knew he was a 26-year-old office clerk, and I knew he played the violin, and I knew he was made of Charlie Chaplin's, and we both playing the violin together. And I knew that he renounced his German citizenship and went and lived in Switzerland when he was a young man. And so he was working at a patent office, and he was 26-year-old when he came up with E=mc² and the theory of relativity in the same year. And he liked music. And so on that trip on the Amazon River, I started writing and basically came up very much on the first day with that the title, Young Einstein. And in 1905, he discovers the theory of relativity. In 1906, he invents rock and roll. And then a little while after that, I had some friends in New York, and I went up and I was continuing writing. It was a big city and everything, and I thought, oh yeah, well, you know, well, gee, I'm in Australia, where do I want to set it? And then I thought of science, and I thought of who was a great guy before Einstein. And Einstein used up all of physics, but, you know, and he had to really invent some new stuff. He failed maths at school, but went on to come up with a whole branch of mathematics. So it says something about the creative mind, and all of this really appealed to me. And so I got quite intense about writing it, but I thought of, well, where do you start? And then I thought of Newton, and then I thought of the Tasmanians, the apple island. And I thought, all right, well, we have this guy sitting under a tree, an apple tree, and the apple falls on his head, and he comes up with all of Newton's theory, and he goes to his mum, and she more or less goes, I mean, what goes up comes down. He goes, yeah. He says, Newton's already discovered that. So there's great, huge amounts of science which are not in this film, which I'll eventually pull out and put together maybe in a documentary. A lot of Australian satire based around physics and science, and I guess growing up in a very egalitarian society like Newcastle. It was a great privilege to also produce a soundtrack which went double platinum.
Questions, because as we've been advertising the screening for the last couple of months, one of the most common themes of things that people are excited about for the movie is the soundtrack. It's this classic Aussie soundtrack, some great artists on there. Did you handpick those artists, or how did that come? How did you involve them?
Some of friends, like Paul Kelly was, and he had a demo that he played for me called Love. Done all the dumb things, and so I had to match that with some dumb stuff. And one of the things that I did is I went and cut it. I used dumb things and cut it in the area of the film. I think he even put it. He cursed me in his autobiography when I said, "Oh, look, it needs to be just exactly like the demo that you played me." He goes, well, we were really bad doing that, and it slows up and speeds up and slows down and then all. And I said, well, it's sort of got to be like that. And then he goes, oh, all right. So they went in and they played faster and slower, and they were trying to match their own demo and stuff. And they finally got it right. And by that time, I filmed a whole lot more, and I had a better spot for it. And Paul really cursed me over that. I was straight southern land. I had a French girlfriend at the time, and we went to a concert, a Bowie concert in just outside of London. And I've been homesick. It was the same trip. I'd been down the Amazon River and was writing Young Einstein. And I think I think someone was supporting Bowie, and it was an English band, and they said something derogatory about Bowie, and he sacked them, and then hired Ivor from Icehouse to go and support, be the supporting act. Anyway, Ivor went on and played a brand new song of his called Great Southern Land, and I went, oh, hang on, I haven't been home for 6 months, and all that, and that resonated with me a lot, and I wanted to, I really wanted to marry it to our culture. So that just continued, and then it continued on in the next film with Mungawoi and Yothi Indi and things. And so, but that first soundtrack was a lot of, you know, there was the Lime Spiders, they were pretty great. There was so many models, really some great Australian bands. And when you're using a lot of rock, it's really hard because it sounds fantastic when it first comes in, but after seconds even, you can start to stray away out of the story of the movie, and once you're outside of the movie, it's really hard to get it going back. So I work with some great, there's a really great old guy called Tommy Tico, and he was a great classical composer, and so I welded a lot of the rock and blues and the jazz and everything together with the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra. So that's why it has a big soundtrack, like it's, I want it to be like a big Lawrence of Arabia or a big Hollywood big thing, because I always thought, well, you know, we're as good as anybody in this country, so we deserve our stories to be on a big stage.
Hasn't actually seen the movie yet.
That's kind
of cool.
Where
are you guys been? That's awesome, because you're going to have a whole new experience now, which is going to be quite interesting. And just in case it wasn't clear when Yao was on stage, he is actually going to hang around and watch the film with you guys. Now, Yahoo, I've got to tell you that when we were asking people through social media to, you know, volunteer some questions and some things that they want to hear about, I mean, you've covered a lot of that stuff, the music, the inspiration, all that kind of thing, the challenge making film. But one thing that did come up, and it's a very serious question, is where did you get the kittens?
Oh. After they were movie stars, it wasn't hard to get them, but they went as quick as they went up. We didn't know if we could find them to do some extra shots because everyone wanted a souvenir one. I don't know if anyone here, or probably the Novocastrians, people from Newcastle would know, but there's a wonderful old fort that actually fired back at the Japanese sub that came up outside of Newcastle during World War II. But they had big gun emplacements, and it was very, very old fort. I think it had been built back in the sailing ship days, and it was called Fort Scratchley. And so one of the young women that was very helpful on keeping the continuity together, she grabbed the first and most beautiful one, and she called it Scratchley. Perfect name for a cat. But there's actually you'll see the cats here, and we just released them. But there was actually a whole other scene where once the cats are released, at the same time there's a whole lot of dogs getting caught by a dog catcher, and this is a scene that isn't in the movie, and so all these this really smart dog. Opens the door and lets all the other dogs out, and they go free at the same time as the cats get free. So there's a whole lot more slapstick comedy. You won't have seen enough.
So that's what happened to the kittens. They're all with happy lives, I'm sure. Well, they're dead now. Definitely dead now.
There are no 30 old cats.
Probably the big question, like the absolute top question in everyone's mind in this room, is to find out why you left. Why you seem to take an active step away from industry, and we'd love to know what you've been doing in the meantime.
I've been around for a while, so I know there's not, you probably can't describe it as an industry. Although we had the first feature length film in the world, and the story of the Kelly Gun, 1905, we were ahead of the whole world. We had a massive industry per head of the population, and it was, I think, even in working out the cost of living, it was for a family to go to the cinema once a week. It was a part of the Australian budget. And the Americans came in and bought up our cinemas and would show Australian films, and then our industry died until the 70s, and then came back in a wave, and I guess I came on the end of that, so it might be my way. And the same thing sort of happening again a little bit, but it's usually, for me, it's always about 7 years a cycle, because I write them and direct them and have to raise the money, and then they go in them and stuff. And so it's about 7 years of a movie. If people ask you what's important, I sort of came across something, I think it answers it in a way, about the importance of the original art. And the difference with the interpretive art. I love the interpretive art. I love doing it. But when I was offered a lot of films that became Hollywood hits, because that's what you're supposed to do when you come to the movie, you're supposed to do what they want you to. And I wasn't really that interested in doing that. But the thing that I explained this thing to be original, to be an artist of your tribe in a way, and that can be of the world itself. For me, it's been about Australia. As I say to people, who played Hamlet? Who was the first person to ever play Hamlet? And I said, well, who directed it? And they go, well, I don't know. And I say, who wrote it? And everyone can answer who wrote Hamlet. And I think that shows you something, the test of time and the importance of the different art forms of what is important. And that way today, people would say, oh, the director's really important, the actor's really important, not the producer. But you don't have a great movie unless you've got a great script. And it's a vague enough thing. If you think about moving pictures and sound, and that's an incredible thing. You see, we could never look back, hundred years ago, we couldn't look back at ourselves as human people, as a species, moving through time in a real way. We didn't know what that was. You could look in the mirror, but all there was paintings, or still, even then, still photographs. But once we could see ourselves moving in time, and then in about 1930 we married sound to it, we had this new art form. It's a baby of an art form, but I used to be a painter, and I stopped painting as soon as I went to art school, because I realised what art could be with this thing where you combine all the different art forms. You know, you've got theatre, and you've got dance, and you've got literature, and you've got painting, you've got a rock band, and you've got a symphony orchestra, you've got everything. So you've got all these different art forms, and within that, all these different interpretations. Within that, and you can do comedy, you can do drama, you can do anything about human existence, and you can see it for real, and people can give you 2 hours of their time, as you're doing 93 minutes, to watch something really about yourself. So that's a great privilege, and if you think in all the history of humankind, this has only been going on since 1930, so it's a baby of an art form. It's like a little kid that's trying to learn to walk, so it's still very primitive in terms of what it's going to be. So what I look forward to is always doing something new, and that's what I will do. I was very privileged in when the movie world and the Gold Coast opened up, they Warner Brothers offered me to be the Australian going to that. And, I've been privileged previously to meet Clint Eastwood when I was releasing Young Einstein, and I went up to him. I'd just come back from my honeymoon in Africa, and I'd stayed in this place, and I'd just seen Black Kind of White Heart, which probably none of you have seen, but one of Clint's movies, and another one called Bird, and I'd seen that, and he was Clint Eastwood, and he was this amazing man, you know, that produces and directs and stars in his stuff, and I just went up and, you know, said, oh, look, I just want to say I love Bird, and I love Black Kind of White Heart, and we talked about them for a little while, and then he came out to Open Movie World with Mel and some other people, and he arrived and you know, we talked about different stuff, and he said, oh, what are you doing, you know? And so I'm going to do Ned Kelly, and he told me, oh, I was asked to do Ned Kelly, and Mick Jagger ended up doing it, but I was going to come out and do that. But then I did a spaghetti western that had me wearing some armour, so I thought, oh, it's too much, and I'm just a young kid, so I thought, no, I won't do that. And so I didn't come out, and I said, oh, what are you doing? He said, I'm doing western. You know, and I said, oh, geez, that's sort of great. And that Western that Clint did was Unforgiven. That was like, that's Academy Award time. That was when all these great, start of his great work. He was a great actor before that and a really, really good director. But he became one of the greats after that. And when he arrived in Australia, we already knew each other. And he said, yeah, look, I cheated it. It was either his 63rd or 64th birthday. And he said, I crossed the date line, and so I skipped my birthday, so I'm actually a year younger. He was in his mid-60s then, which I am now. So he gives me hope that it's sort of okay to do stuff. And I have been writing, I don't know. You don't know if people are going to like it or just get too radical, or you know, you've just lost the plot or whatever. I hope and I think I will, but continue to make some movies.
Except maybe the 12 people haven't seen it. Now, yeah, just before we wrap things up, I just wanted you to quickly touch on the Kokoda Track Foundation, which you're part of, and just tell us a little bit about what that is and what you've been doing with them, because you may not realise there's actually $5 per ticket tonight going towards that very good cause.
Yes, I'm one of the founding directors. We founded in, I think, 2002, the Kokoda Track Foundation, and we do a lot of work. That's a non-government organisation and a not-for-profit organisation. I've always seen Papua New Guinea as something very special, and it was a filmmaker that made it special for me on Anzac Day. They used to run a lot of great old Australian films, like Charles Revell films like Rats of Tobruk and 40,000 Horsemen, and they'd run them. Put the march on in the morning on telly, and then they'd run all this stuff. And they also would run these newsreels that used to be in when I was a kid. They'd have these little cinemas that you just would go in and they'd run the news because there wasn't not too many people had television. And in fact, I remember when we first got television, I was 5, and really changed the world. One of these particular newsreels they used to run was our first Academy Award. It was called Kokoda Frontline. It was by a guy called Damien Parra, and he died not on Kokoda, but he turned it around, and when Australians were told they were cowards for retreating on the Kokoda track, he and some others told the real story, which was the fact that we decided to keep withdrawing and stretch the Japanese lines, and we became the first allies to defeat the Japanese in Papua New Guinea. And I've always realised that, and we wouldn't have done that without the people of Papua New Guinea. It was a wonderful partnership, and that was always an incredible story. So it's like a, it's one of the few justifiable times when we march off to war, because the Japanese had their money printed and they were coming to Australia. Now they'd already been bombing Australia, I met a lot of the Japanese, not a lot, but some survivors that said, yeah, we were coming, that's what we were doing. And the Australians, I got very privileged to get to know a lot of the diggers up there, and they knew that they were fighting to save their families here. Everyone thought that Australia would get invaded. So we're imperialist fighters in the Middle of War, fighting to survive. So that's what got me interested in that, and I've been writing a World War II, stringing together all the Australian stories in World War II. And so I was interested in the Picada track and went up there and dedicating the, I think the most beautiful memorial, I guess, to Australians fighting anywhere, it's like the Nishirava on the Dakota track. We've got to do something about these the people on the track, because the kids aren't too healthy and all that. We started this small foundation. Now I think over the last 24 months we've educated 3,000 teachers, and we partner with the Australian government and the Papua New Guinea government. We've picked the 6, 7, 8 brightest kids around the country and put them through university and be the leaders of tomorrow. We're lighting up PNG now. We laid up the Dakota track with solar lights. So the kids, it's wonderful now when you go up. Just lately, over the last year or two, the kids are out there doing their homework in the night instead of sitting by the fire where there's a whole lot of smoke or it's a kerosene lamp, and they're all getting sick now. Their mothers go out in the day and put the solar-powered solar things on their back, and they bring it in, and it's a light that they can cook by, and they can charge their mobile phones, so they're doubling, they can sell their vegetables much better and stuff, and so they're doubling their income. And we just go to places that